So we'll talk about sea turtles. I'm going to tell you where I am now, where I come from, and a couple stories. This photo was controversial for Rick to put in the program. Usually they want just a portrait of a guy or a lady and be serious. But he said, "Now let me try it." And probably because the sign on the right, on your right, says, "Do not touch the sea turtles" in Japanese. Anyway, I'm going to tell you where I am now. I'm at the executive director of the New School of Conservation, a partnership between Smithsonian Institution and George Mason University. And yes, we are closed. However, all personnel essential now, because of federal property, is faculty and students, so we're able to continue the courses there. So we're very grateful for that support. It is a new campus. I invite you to come visit. Brand new facility, academic center, dining hall, and residence hall for about 120 people. You can run events there if you like to, related to conservation or sustainability. And we have a very straightforward mission, and that's to conserve global biodiversity and advance the theory and practice of conservation biology with a very specific education in a way of transformative and transdisciplinary, and I think we are achieving that. We have wonderful values about Earth, about life, including diversity, sustainability, passion, leadership, and of course, lifelong learning across our networks. We are a LEED Gold certified facility. In fact, the architect just received an award by these associations that evaluate these type of buildings because of this educational facility. And we just got a certification for Academic Center. It's kind of a weird partnership because the Academic Center was built by Smithsonian, the residence hall, dining hall, and the residence and the dining was built by Mason by the same contractors but different contracts. So you see the differences, like furniture for one is by the state of Virginia, you have to buy it from prison system. In Smithsonian, you have to buy somewhere else, so the furniture is different too. And actually, there's a road dividing us, but we're trying to look like one. We offer an undergrad semester. If you are undergraduate, you can come for a whole semester, spend 16 credits of your career there. We offer two semesters, one in applied conservation strategies, other one in ecology of effective conservation, and both are really hands-on conservation, a little bit on sustainability. You to spend time with the scientists, with the animal keepers, with the managers, policy makers. We offer also graduate professional programs, about 16 graduate professional courses, two or three credits. This is just an example of a couple coming up from conflict resolution to species monitoring to estimating animal abundance and leadership. We just started last summer a very popular program. We didn't realize that high school kids were so interested in conservation. So they come in the summer for a week and learn a little bit about nature, biodiversity. And one important thing to understand that they are not the weird person in their society, in their community. I was amazed of four of these young kids all agreed and all they told me, all my family and friends, they think I'm different. And that I'm a weirdo here. And now I realize that there's a lot like us out there. And that happened to me as I was growing up. So we offer many conferences and retreats to many organizations like this. And that's our website, if you're interested to look at our programs. We have an evening series too. I know it's a long drive to Front Royal, but some people not mind the drive. And there's a couple good restaurants that I can recommend. 72 wineries, we can start there. Tom Lovejoy, a professor and well-known scientist in biodiversity, gave me this slide. And he said, you know, this reminds me of you, or you veterinarians, you planetary doctors. And my second book, he wrote the preface or the foreword. And here we're studying the planet. Dr. Planet is looking at the planet with a good stack of books, and then of course a nice bowl of wine, and looking at how to solve the most imminent problems that the planet is passing through. But yet, before or below his feet, the whole planet is melting. And that has been the problem of many scientific disciplines. They don't know how to collaborate, how to reach out. We started talking about how to connect, how people can care about the environment. And one way is through health. We know that health connects all species in the planet. We know, for example, when West Nile hit New York, realized that it will affect animals, will affect mosquitoes, will affect humans, domestic animals. In the mid-90s, we came with the concept of conservation medicine, looking at the center as ecological health and seeing these connections with the environment and human health. The first book came in 2002. And the most powerful magazine in human research or human health research coming from NIH recognizes a new discipline using the three circles, trying to connect humans, ecosystems, and animals. The second book just came out last year with about 45 chapters, brand new book. And we have a journal if you're interested in a topic or finding a scholarship or a master's or a job related to conservation medicine, One Health, Eco Health, or even public health, this is an outlet that we've been using. After all these years, we're finding that biodiversity makes a difference. We know, for example, that here in the Congo, do you know where is this? The middle shot, anybody? Nobody wants to risk? That's Brasilia. That's one of the few planned cities in the planet where it was stuck in the middle of the Amazon. You couldn't get there until recently by only flying in. And of course, New York. All of these are different ecosystems, and all of them consider humans. And that has been the issue. We have taken away humans from the environment, realizing that we are part of it in many ways, locally and globally. There's many drivers that are changing the face of this planet that we've been talking about for years. We know that habitat destruction, just going to a forest, cutting the trees down. We are able to move pathogens with something that we call pathogen pollution. In evolution, you know normal evolving viruses or bacteria adapting to new hosts. Now we are flying with our own bugs, moving them around. Remember SARS? That disease when the Chinese recognized that we had a problem in 3 months, that was February of 2003, when the first case was November of 2002. So basically 4 months, we had 40 countries, 4,000 infected, and 400 fatalities. So we can see how fast a disease or a pathogen can be moving around. A new concept that we introduced in a new book, global toxification, we're releasing all these chemicals to the biosphere without having the techniques to monitor them. 150,000 of them are floating in there, and we don't really know the impact of these substances. And we talk about rapid global travel. I'm the living proof, I can be in one country within 24 hours, gone and back, urbanization again, and just to cap it all, climate change. And so looking at all these factors, this is what we focus our efforts in developing teams and identify problems. Now I'm gonna tell you a little bit about me, but also just telling you that the ocean's now in big trouble. My geography teacher will tell us many, many years ago that the future of humanity was the oceans. Why? Because fish and wild animals in the oceans, there's no way to deplete them. She was so wrong that we are able, within just a lifetime, deplete every single food chain, really, throughout the planet. And the problem is that destruction of these marine ecosystems will have profound effects on the health of everyone. Do you know? Do you see the human footprint there? There. That's supposed to be one of the most pristine islands in the planet, in the northwestern Hawaiian Islands. So what you see there is green turtles, known to bask there, only to bask. That's the only species that we know that gets out to get some sun, as far as we know, besides laying eggs, of course. And then we have a monk seal at the background, and a Lysa albatross, three very iconic species for the Hawaiian Islands. This is a monk seal too, But why are we in trouble? Well, we know that less than 1% of the marine habitats are protected, mostly coral reefs, coastal, and seafloor. And more, we know there's more 50,000 species in one coral reef. But we only know by evidence the extinction of 4 snails, 5 birds, and 3 marine mammals. That's as far as we know, how little we know about the oceans in many ways. There's a lot of dead zones throughout the oceans now, the size of New Zealand. Over 35% of mangroves have been lost in the last 30 years. And then a lot of destruction around the wetlands that's also causing global emissions. We don't think about these problems. So basically, in growing in Baja California, my grandmother used to give to the pigs at this level of fish. At this point, he told me it may not work. So let's go like halfway here. All the big fish over there is pretty much gone. And then what we're eating now is red snappers about this size. When I remember as a kid, they were about this size. And many species that we find that way. This is an interesting case that came last year. In Japan, you know bluefin tuna is a delicacy. Well, one over 500-pound bluefin tuna goes for record for 750,000 in Tokyo. So you can basically say that people are buying a pound of tuna for $2,000, and they'll pay it. This is just the auctioneer during the auction. So you can imagine how much that animal was sold to the public. And why? Because there's no more tuna this size. So yes, there are very few. Just look at this picture very carefully. This is a map that Christensen did a few years ago, looking at a biomass of table fish in 1900. And you can tell the red here is over 1,000, so 11 tons per square kilometer. And you go down all the way to less than one in the light blue. We know these are very highly productive ecosystems for fisheries. But then you remember The Perfect Storm, a movie that came. The Georges Bank fish were depleted. These guys had to leave the coast of Massachusetts going for fish because they weren't getting any fish. But that's happened about 1988. So by 2000, this is what the picture is. So basically, we have depleted every single ecosystem in big fish. And to add up, we have the big North Pacific gyre with what we call the Pacific garbage patch. So the size of Texas, very deep, and is 6 times more plastic than plankton. And this is just a photo of a guy canoeing through that zone that hasn't been able to be removed. Now we found another one in the Atlantic. And climate change really now is responsible for a lot of extinctions. These are just calculations about 10 years ago, that 35% of 1,000 animal species and plant species are in risk of extinction from climate change alone. So we're trying to come up with ways to cope with this depletion of fish. Let's build these huge towers in the middle of the ocean where we can grow bluefin tuna, we can grow yellowfin tuna, we can grow snappers, even salmon. But I'm not sure this is the way to go, but what I recommend is if you can eat a fish that has these labels of Marine Stewardship Council, certified sustainable seafood, or certified from the best aquaculture practices, you probably are okay. I say probably because I found out that these guys from the Marine Stewardship Council are certifying people that's not totally has passed the test of sustainability, but they're giving them 5 years to clean up their act and then be able to be sustainable. So we don't necessarily may get the best, but it is always a good guide. Now we see a lot of interactions happening between land and sea. Basically, we decide in California to flush the cat litters down the toilet, literally. And that allowed a parasite, toxoplasma, that circulates between mice and cats as definite hosts, that's the disease that they tell pregnant women to be careful with your cat, because of course it's a disease that can affect humans too. But now we are having sea otters in California dying of toxoplasma, or severe encephalitis, and the toxo is identical to the cat strain. Obviously that came from the terrestrial ecosystem into humans. That's what we call pathogen pollution. That's what I was telling you earlier. Now we're seeing Giardia in moxoxen, the toxoplasma, and adding algal blooms and global environmental change, we're gonna start seeing more of these effects in the environment. So that's where I was born, along the ocean. My grandfather was a captain. He had two boats, fishing boats. My grandmother was the president of the cooperative, because that's actually along the western coast of Baja, there's several cooperatives, and they are sustainable. They've been able to survive all these years, and their fisheries hasn't been collapsing because fishermen served as their own policemen. So they protect abalone. You can have so much take of abalone or lobster. So 6 months and 6 months, and then they can use other practices. I'll give you an example on sea turtles later on what's happened. It's a huge ecosystem, highly diverse. 80% of the marine mammals in the Pacific Ocean go there to feed. Nowhere else in the planet you'll see 40 blue whales feeding in the same spot. So you can think the amount of biomass and the amount of organisms for a whale to feed in. A blue whale that's about the size of, from side to side of this room, maybe a little bit larger. That's me and my first pet. My grandfather took this photo. I was 4 years old. I knew since then that I was interested in animals and the environment. I've been fortunate with my job as a wildlife veterinarian, as Rick said, to work in about 23 countries in one level or another. So I'm gonna give you examples before we into sea turtles. I work in Australia. I work in the Arctic with foxes. I worked in India. These people were really upset because we crossed across the elephants to touch them, but I work in South Africa, work in Patagonia with foxes, work with manatees too, work with dolphins. This is a La Plata dolphin in, and teaching how to do a proper necropsy because of the massive bycatch. And turtles in Amazonia, three species of Podocnemis. Finally, on sea turtles. It was taken in Hawaii. If you can see, this turtle has some growths here, a little growth, here, a little growth. And that's a disease called fibropapilloma. So for years, and we just were talking, I was in Atlanta, actually in Athens, Georgia, just last week. We got from National Science Foundation $1.4 million to work on the macro ecology of disease, looking at pathogens on a global way. And we just were talking that 20 years ago, ecologists will just recognize disease as part of the environment. It's just a factor there. But because all the changes that are happening to the planet and what we're doing to it, now we have a huge interest by ecologists in this field. Back then I couldn't get a job. I was jobless writing grants for 5 years. And now there's so many positions available, so I'm just about 20 years ahead of my time. But I was always telling them if there's stressors in a population, like contaminants, that's gonna add up to that population and diminish or cause depression of the immune system. And that's going to make animals susceptible or populations susceptible to disease. Now we're seeing that disease is the last brick that's leading a species to extinction or severe decline. And there's many examples like white nose syndrome, like the chytrid fungus in frogs, and many, many of those. So let's get into sea turtles for the next 20 minutes. Or we have time. And let you know for the next 15 minutes or so a little bit of natural history, then some of the problems that turtles are facing today, and then a specific example that I've been working for a few years. Basically, there's 7 or 8 species of sea turtles, depends on who you talk to. According to many scientists, the black turtle and the green turtle, Pacific black and Pacific green, that is located in Hawaii, is the same species. The black turtle that belongs to the Pacific coast of Mexico is a subspecies of that green. I think they're different for many traits, but genetically and with many studies, they've been showing them as the same. So we have the largest turtles, the leatherback, doesn't have a hard shell, but has skin, and that's the largest of sea turtles, the size of a beetle, the car beetle. about 2,000 tons, that's the largest found so far. Then we have loggerheads. They distinguish because of their big head. In fact, that's what they're called in Spanish, big head or yellow turtles. We have also the olive ridleys and the Kemp's ridley. The Kemp's ridley is an interesting case because only found to nest in Tamaulipas, Mexico. And several reintroduction programs have moved millions of eggs from Tamaulipas into Texas. And finally, after all these years, you start seeing Kemp's ridley increasing in numbers. But there's only about 3,000 left of them. Olive ridleys are very common, and they come in arribadas, meaning they come in massive numbers to lay eggs. And that's a controversial story of the consumption of eggs by Costa Ricans, that they collect the first one or two arribadas to sell within the market, and then they let the turtles lay their eggs. The problem is that humans were too anthropocentric and selfish, so we decide that just a few eggs are not enough. We have to take them all. And that's why we cannot be sustainable. And finally, the green turtle that I work the most and that people really enjoy because of their flavor, they eat them. In general, sea turtles have a very interesting cycle. They mate in the same area where they are born or they lay their eggs. And so you'll see these turtles will nest, and then a lot of, after 30 days or so, about 100 little creatures will come out of the shells. About 100 eggs are laid. About 1,000 eggs are laid by a female within the same season. That tells you the way of the species protecting themselves to live a long term. We know that only one egg out of those 1,000 eggs is going to make it to adulthood. So it takes a long time for these turtles to be an adult, between 25 to 40 years, depends on the species. So we get into the lost years, open ocean. They end up returning to the coral reef areas. These are the feeding areas when they are about 2 to 5 years old. And they'll remain there for a long time, and then they'll migrate, eventually returning to mate. Many threats to the species. These are all photos from U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, but still useful. You know that lights are devastating for and destruction of all those beaches where turtles nest. Also, the illegal take of sea turtles and their eggs, a common practice in many countries still. And of course, these are in an airport, but also this is a cemetery in Nicaragua, where several of those were back in the 70s and 80s, as they call them just the butcher place to bring turtles and slaughter them for skin, eggs, and meat. There's many natural predators. George Balas from Hawaii shared this photo with me taken back in the 70s. And that's a tiger shark that swallowed a whole sea turtle. You can see the turtle coming out of the stomach of the shark. But they have other natural predators, like when they're babies, many gulls and crabs will eat these turtles. We have tried to cope with the issue of bycatch by building these TEDs, or turtle excluder devices, that many fishermen of many countries, they don't want to use. I don't know why. But basically, it's to fish shrimp. And that's why they tell you shrimp is the worst seafood you can eat, unless you know it's local or certified, as I told you. Not only because of the fishing, you know, bycatch of sea turtles and seabirds, but because also the culture shrimp, depending of it comes from, like Peru or China, Taiwan, and also Ecuador, you destroy the mangrove, you import tiger shrimp from Thailand, for example. Some of that shrimp spills over the ocean, so you contaminate your local shrimp genetically. Then you spread pesticides to kill all the mangrove plants left over. Some of that spills over to the ocean. Then we bring antibiotics so we can have large and healthy shrimp that also spills over into the ocean. And then all this shrimp is flown to all the developed countries like Japan, Germany, England, of course the United States and Canada and Australia, where 90% of the consumption happens. And so you have to be, you want to do something good for the oceans from home, just check all the shrimp you're eating. And that will be very important to do. I show you a little bit of the garbage patch already, but this is the main cause of mortality of any sea organism. Seabirds, marine mammals, sea turtles. The main cause of mortality, and other fish too, is fisheries bycatch, by far. Doesn't matter how you look at the data, it's 80% of your animals are being killed unintentionally by these techniques. And you can see just here a few examples of leatherback strangle, many hooks, fish hooks we see in sea turtles that are coming to a clinic. And we used to do that in Hawaii. They still do it. Or turtles just being caught with the nets. This is my first trip to Hawaii back in 1990, a long time ago. And we started working with sea turtles back then to look at this disease. This is sea turtle fibropapilloma. That's a tumor, mostly benign. However, 3 to 5% of the cases we have seen, they are mild fibrosarcomas that have caused severe lesions to sea turtles and to all species, mostly greens and most loggerheads. But all species have been documented with tumors. They grow fairly fast. You can see a normal eye with a little tiny first sign. This is the first sign I ever saw for sea turtles. Hard to biopsy because it's a very delicate area. And then, of course, they will grow to this. Can we remove them? Yes. Some of these turtles, can they see? Some yes, some no, depending on how the tumor grows. This is the only place that we saw tumors in Hawaii inside the mouth. Nowhere else have been documented. 30% of turtles will have tumors in their mouth when they have external tumors. And you can see here the fibrosarcoma. You see the normal bone here, no bone here. So we thought maybe it was the pressure of the tumor causing what we call ischemia. That means just the pressure dies out the tissue and the bone is just dead. But no, we actually saw infiltration of the tumor into the bone and causing the lesion. We also have them inside, like fibromas, myxofibromas, leiomyomas. This is a lung with three big balloons on tissue. 30% of the turtles with tumors externally will have them internally. So there's not much to do about these sea turtles. And they have what we call a pantropic distribution. We have documented disease basically in all major oceans. Interestingly, no single case in the Mediterranean. And we have there three species of sea turtles. Never documented there, and I don't know why. So it'll be an interesting spot to study. But we have seen them from Australia to Florida to Brazil, now Chile, Argentina. We have seen turtles in Western Africa. So basically, everywhere we look, we see tumors. So for years, growing in Baja, we'll go with my uncle with a boat about 5 miles away from the coast in Baja, and we'll see all these small loggerheads about this size. To a point that you'll see the ocean, what we call boiling, because the turtles will come up and breathe, so you see a lot of bubbles in the water. And there'll be hundreds of them. But we never saw the large adult turtles. A good friend and colleague of mine, Jay Nichols, he was doing his PhD in sea turtles in Mexico around in 1990s. And so they decided to put a radio transmitter, finally developed in the late 1990s, affordable anyway. It cost you about $10,000 to put a radio in one of these animals and follow up for a few months or a year. So he was able to rehab Adelita, that's the name of the turtle, a loggerhead, in a rehab center that was run by the government. by Antonio Resendiz, also a good friend of mine. And they decided to put in a delita the radio transmitter to figure out the life cycle of loggerheads. So we always thought that they will swim south, like the black turtle, and they'll have a place there that we haven't identified for nesting. But no, the turtle swam all the way to Japan. So we found now that the Japanese are complaining that the turtles are declining, but also there was a lot of bycatch of turtles along Baja. So, and you can see there the data by Jay Nichols that did all this work and provided the maps, that it's all of a sudden the largest migratory route of a marine animal. So with more radio transmitters, we were able to see that they hatch in Japan, they go all the way for feeding along the Pacific coast. Many remain in the central Pacific. But then after 20, 25 years, they return to Japan to nest. But then what happens to the adults? The adults don't stay in Japan. They go to China, Vietnam, and Southeast Asia. So really complicates the process of conservation of single species and how you can work with other countries to look at the decline of these species. So we just pointing out. So when I was growing up, my grandfather used to give us blood, sea turtle blood. And then he'll cook a couple, supposed to be good for asthma and other respiratory problems. Then I found out there's 57 or so parasites or hemoparasites of sea turtles in their blood. Now I see why I end up this way. But no, seriously, I always thought I was wrong to eat sea turtles, but it's a huge culture in northwestern Mexico. And so two issues I'm gonna tell you about tonight to wrap up this. One is the bycatch issue, the largest known for the world, and then the issue of consumption and what we're trying to do about it. So Jay and other NGOs established the Sea Turtle Conservation Network of California. You can type that name and you'll find other meetings. It's a group of fishermen, their kids, scientists, biologists, and more people. We go out there, this is actually in Hawaii, but we collect a blood sample, we measure them, we take a skin tab. This is a way turtles were used back in Australia. The year is early 1900s. And actually, people will use turtles for this thing. That was amazing. That was a National Geographic show. But then we'll release them. And now people are more careful identifying the problems. The problem as a species decline is that you lose the species, number one. But number two, you may lose a culture. So in the Sea of Cortez, you see a large island called Tiburon Island. And the Seri tribe, the Seri thing that sea turtles, in this case leatherback turtles, are the center of their culture and their universe. So they used to have a ceremony with a little shrine. They will paint the turtle, they'll dance, they'll eat, they'll drink for a few days, and then they let the turtle go. But since the late 1980s, no single leatherback came back to nest. So they stopped doing the ceremony. So the next generation was losing all to do about this ceremony. And so Jay and others decided to restart the ceremony with a bone of sea turtle they found on the beach. And now through the Sea Turtle Californians, the people are just starting to integrate the importance of sea turtles in their culture. So we started at two spots. One is Laguna Ojo de Liebre, of course in the south, in Cabo, and then Magdalena Beach. Those were three spots. Now this is the current, relatively current map of all the people monitoring sea turtles and trying to protect them throughout Baja. And has worked to a point, the steel consumption, illegal consumption, but we're trying to stop that. I told you about the high sea turtle consumption, and this is actually one of the campaments that Jay found back in his work as a PhD student. He was to do the research of turtles when he realized the problem was every time he tagged an animal will be killed by a community and eat it. So he took a different term in his career. So they started a campaign many years ago when Bush was still in power. And they released these cards for the fishermen, for the people, let's try this campaign. Basically saying, eating sea turtle makes you slow. And that's a photo from the White House, actually. But that didn't work. We say, oh yeah, well, Bush doesn't eating sea turtle or not, you know, it's gonna be the way he's gonna be. So that was tried by torturamarina.com. Then they tried another campaign. These posters were released. This is with the most clothes on them, but basically, Doris Mara, a professional Argentinian model, famous in Mexico, they say, my man doesn't need any eggs of sea turtles to make me happy. But because he knows they don't make them more potent, and that's a tradition. You eat two sea turtle eggs and then you'll be much better. Your virility will increase. And we have done tests where only two sea turtle eggs and a chicken egg, they're exactly the same. Same content. But that didn't change either, just caused a lot of controversy. So we brought health as a powerful motivator. Maybe with conservation medicine, we can change the way we see things. Several studies were done. This paper was published by a few researchers in Mexico looking at cadmium. And we know cadmium is detrimental for many organs. And you can see the levels in whales, 2 to 35 micrograms, to plankton, to mollusks, up to 350. But then you see sea turtles, more than 650 in cadmium. And you know levels of 13 micrograms are enough to cause renal damage in humans. So maybe we tell people, you continue consuming sea turtles, you're gonna have some problems in health. And that has worked a little bit. We released a paper back in 2006 listing all the potential diseases a human can get. We're working hard on that campaign. Many people are trying to integrate sea turtles as part of the culture and turning the business into ecotourism. But it's not easy. The other problem I was telling you is the sea turtle bycatch. And this is the problem with the yellow headed turtle, as we call it, or the caguama, or loggerheads. I told you about the little babies of about this size, along Baja. Well, now about 2001, we started seeing they were washing out into Bahia Magdalena. On the hundreds, so far about 10,000 of them. And discovered that small fisheries bycatch is a problem. So the local fishermen will go out with their nets up to a mile long nets and bycatching turtles. By the time we got them, they were too rotten to look at the cost. This was about 2 years ago. We call these cemeteries along this bay or this long beach in San Lorenzo. And we look at the number of carcasses, pile them up. Hoy Peckham is heavily involved in the project. In fact, he had to open his own NGO because the government was putting too much pressure for him to pursue this issue of bycatch. And so recently, with their support, I decided to write a letter to the president of Mexico telling them that the research has been done. We know bycatch is a problem. Do something about it. Change the way fishermen take their fish. I don't know. There's many ways that we can turn a community in a better way moving forward. That's where we do the surveys. We collect the carcasses. This is Don Victor de la Toba. He was the one that will collect all these carcasses through the whole season. We'll go capture animals, evaluate their health for about 3 or 4 years. We have done that. And we have written the reports to say this, collecting some samples, how it in the background, and releasing them back in the wild. And yet we see that fisheries is a problem. So the issue is how you are able to cross borders. Finally, we were able to bring the Japanese into Mexico so they can see their turtles and why they are declining. And we're developing collaborative projects with Japan and with Vietnam and China, hopefully, to integrate them into a better way of sustaining sea turtles. This is a team with Aaron Sleeman, president of Sea Turtle of of the California San Jose Peckham. So at the end, as part of my title, I use sentinel as an animal that will tell you something about the environment. And I think sea turtles are telling us what's happening to the oceans. First with those tumors, second with the massive bycatch that's happening. And we're looking at all these stressors in a multiple synergistic way. Just to finalize a sentinel species, you will just will give us enough scientific information to try to teach about the environment, the public, stakeholders, and decision makers. Although our decision makers are not very good decision makers, are they? Instead, we go into some other issues. Now we see how important what we do, we dump into the oceans, is having severe effects in many ways. We have to look at ecosystem-based management, not only species or groups. We have to see at the whole system. We have to develop effective partnerships. That's the hardest part of what we do. And also the slogan of thinking globally and acting locally, I added up that also thinking locally, we should act globally. We need to do a lot of surveillance, research, of course, trying to train the public, involve them into projects. The community involvement is basic to succeed in many of these projects, as you saw. We have to achieve a balance. As Ezequiel Escurra, who was head of the San Diego Natural Museum, saying that deserts and the seas can endure without us, but we cannot survive without them. Thank you for your attention.